1, go.
Start the run?
No. Okay, everybody, so this is Gravity Rush Remastered. I'm Steve the Wizard.
And I'm Internet Movie Guy. I'll be the runner for today.
And I will be doing commentary.
This run we want to submit so that people at GDQ can see what they can expect from a Gravity Rush speedrun. We hope it will be very entertaining.
Alright, so here we go. Hope you guys enjoy. And we'll start in 3, 2, 1, go.
Alright. So, first up, let's discuss Apple Strats.
So, Apple Strats are pretty interesting. Start off the opening cutscene, and then the game tells you to press the X button to tap the apple. And you pretty much mash the X button as fast as you possibly can.
It's really, really interesting and fun.
This
Don't
is where
worry.
The vast majority of time loss comes in.
Alright, I'm already starting. Just make sure. Oh, okay, got past.
Alright, looking All good, right. looking
so,
good.
Steve, could you explain cutscene skips?
Come yes, on. So this game, for some really dumb reason, has really random weird cutscene skips where you have to wait until really specific points for the game to allow you to skip the cutscene like that. We had to wait until she finished Etsu. And it doesn't really make sense, especially because this game was originally a Vita game, and in that version of the game, you could instantly skip every cutscene, but I don't know, for some reason, they were like, hey, let's just make the cutscene skips kind of, random disabled controller speaker. So, in the beginning of the run, we always have to change the settings, just to make sure that we can, you know, maximum camera sensitivity, and the controller speaker... for recording run purposes, if it was enabled, there wouldn't be audio coming through the game. It would be coming out of the speaker of the controller. So we try to turn that off so that you guys can hear all the audio going on. All right, this beginning part of the game is pretty much just kind of a tutorial. Like, it's pretty narrow and you can't really do much. There's not a lot of, like, time save here. Usually we get somewhere around, takes about 5 minutes just to get through it. You gotta watch every cutscene, and game tells you how to do everything.
So this is the part, though, where they introduce to you the main mechanic of the game. Steve, would you like to go over the gravity shifting?
Yeah, so gravity shifting... Oh man, we're getting some frame drops. Jeez, what the... No, on it. Okay,
Don't worry about the
scene. Okay, so the main shifting in this, or the gravity shifting being the main mechanic in this game, is where you basically press the R1 button, and you float. And then when you look in any direction, you'll have a little reticle thing. And then you press R1, and you just fall that way. Which is really awesome.
It's kind of like Superman 64, if it was actually good.
Yeah, I guess so. And so in this, so right now we have to wait for the cutscene skip, and then some of these cutscenes, like this upcoming one right here, you can skip immediately, but I don't know, it doesn't make sense. So anyway, so the game right now, he's just gravity shifting. This is just a scripted part. We can't affect the way that she shifts, but it's just kind of to show you that this is what it looks like, and he'll soon gain control of his gravity powers, but not immediately. And when Cat is red like this, it means that she's standing or she's shifted in some way. So, like, the main gravity is down to the left, but when she's red like this, it means she's not standing on normal ground. Anything you'd like to add?
Yeah, so there's a few types of cutscene skips. I'd rather go over them right now to get them out of the way. So there's the normal cutscene skips, like the one we saw, Yuji! You have to wait for him to finish saying Yuji. And then there's dialogue skips. We have these dialogues. You can skip them immediately by pushing the options button. And then there is comic skips. Now, Steve, would you like to talk about double skips? In comics?
Yeah, so the comics are, like, you pretty much have to skip them, and, I don't exactly...
So if you skip it too early, what you get we call a double skip.
Oh.
Where you pause and you skip it, and it doesn't actually skip, because you were a bit too early. We don't understand why, but that's just the way they did it.
Yeah, definitely. It sucks when, like, you're just ready to, like, mash the options button, because you know that the comic's coming up, but then the game, like, is trying to, like, load the comic, and then you pause the, like, loading sequence almost. It's really annoying. so that can be frustrating. But there are certain parts in this game where you can mash to skip scenes, and then there are other parts in this game where you can't mash because the game will punish you. So that was the tutorial section. Now we're just waiting on a few more cutscene and comic skips. We're coming up to catching Dusty. So this is just the beginning. This is again more of a tutorial type part. And you see the Dusty's running away, but the fun part is that you can actually beat Dusty to where we're trying to go if you cut the corners and jump the stairs. We got the stair strats.
Stair strats are very important. Faster, just like in Yoshi's Island, it's faster to jump upstairs.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, not the... although most of the game you end up just shifting wherever you want to go, so stairs aren't important. There's actually quite a few sections in the game where you don't have gravity, and stair jumping saves a couple seconds here and there. So there we just had to stop and trigger the scene, and we're just waiting on this crow. And there's a few times in this game where the game's like, oh, go and catch this thing, and we're like just waiting for it because it takes so long.
And during those scenes, we typically try to collect gems, which we'll explain in a bit. But yeah. Right now, let's explain the gravity meter that we have.
So here. The gravity meter is that blue ring on the left, and what that does is it, as you shift gravity, it decreases over time, and when it runs out, you have to wait for it to recover. And these blue gems that he's collecting right now immediately refill the gravity gauge. And so early on, the gauge is weaker, it depletes faster, and it takes about 4 seconds to recover. And then as we progress through the game, we'll be upgrading the gauge usage so we can stay in shifted form for longer periods of time, because that becomes really helpful. So here's how your main source of combat is kicking. This being, we're using jump kicks and these three kicks to kill these early ones, and now we're using the most important combat tool, which is gravity kick. Which is how you take care of most of the enemies in the game.
That was weird.
Yeah, so the auto-targeting in this game, sometimes it feels really nice, and other times it just doesn't really help.
There we go.
So that right there was called the straggler skip, in which there's a tutorial thing, but you actually... But we can skip that by aiming exactly where he's gonna be so that right when we spawn, he can kill him. Oh, I didn't split. So now we have to go over and collect these gems. And do you want to talk a little bit about gems?
All right, absolutely. So now gems are the main currency, you could say, of the game. The only thing you can buy, though, is more upgrades for Cat. Right now I just collect the gems, just showing you that I can collect these gems. Luckily, Cat has magnet hands, so the gems come right to her. I don't actually have to go and touch them every single time. Leeway, which is nice.
Mm-hmm.
Throughout the game, we'll be using these gems to upgrade, in particular, four major stats.
Yes, those four stats being gauge usage, gravity kick, which are the two most important tools for both movement and combat, stasis field, and then the special move known as Gravity Typhoon, which we'll pick up around halfway, or I don't know, like one third of the way through the game.
Steve, could you explain your findings on how significant it is to upgrade Gravity Gauge?
Gravity Gauge, like, the first, the issue with most of the level ups in this game is that, like, they don't give you a significant increase, like when it comes to things like recovery speed and other types of level ups, but gauge usage is really helpful for leveling up, because it gives you like a solid like 3-4 extra seconds, and then even some of the later levels it gives you an extra like 7 seconds. So we upgraded, I think it's a total of 8 times throughout the run.
We upgraded 7 times to level.
Oh yeah, that's right. And that first upgrade is a scripted one where that's the only thing you're allowed to upgrade, and that's teach you the mechanic of upgrading in the game.
In a low percent run, we won't be talking about much, is that's the only upgrade you would get, because it's forced.
And so right now, basically, Kat's trying to make a little home for herself in the sewers. It's real classy. And we're going to pick up each different kinds of objects to make, I guess, the sewer pipe a little bit more homely. So we have the chair, and then upcoming are a desk and a bed that we'll be picking up.
And then the rest of the stuff she gets through a very, very entertaining comic,
mm-hmm.
which we'll be skipping again.
And so what's really fun and interesting about this game is just because you have the ability to shift in any direction, your movement options are like just really kind of limitless, you know, and each time there's little optimizations you can make, and routing out like exactly where you need to go in the fastest route is really cool. Like, instead of just taking always the direct route, like for one of the upcoming chapters, we'll be going underneath the building instead of over it like you would in any sort of normal game, I guess. Which is just always a fun thing.
Now, our typically in this going back to gems, typically we route it out so we collect as many gems as we can without wasting time. Mm-hmm. So any gem that's on the path, we will collect. Threshold. That's
the upgrade.
Threshold.
The upgrade thresholds. It's most important that we reach the upgrades that we need instead of So more so than just collecting whatever gems we can. But we try to get as many gems that are directly within our path to get the things that we need to get. And there's a few places where we, you know, waste a few maybe seconds or two just going out of the way to get some gems. But then the amount of time that it saves with those upgrades is extremely crucial. So in this upcoming fight, we're trying to get this bed and these Nevi spawn. And so what he's using now is called the stasis field, which is pressing the circle button allows you to pick up objects, and then you can point it and then throw it, and it'll like auto target to certain enemies. And it's really nice, especially, I mean, just throughout the game, but early on. But of course, sometimes they hit pillars and just shatter, and it's not fun. So they one-shot these enemies, which is really nice, especially because our gravity kick's kind of weak because we don't have enough investment into it yet. And so that allows us to take care of a lot of enemies from a range. And the auto-targeting for the the auto-targeting for the stasis objects are pretty good usually, but sometimes, like we said, you can get things in the way and it just gets really annoying.
So some stasis objects are better than others. Like the can is by far the best option in the game. Unfortunately, we only get to see it once in the run if we're lucky.
And so this is the thing I was talking about earlier, where we decide to go underneath the building just because it's a little bit faster, and we pop up on this bridge, and he's right there. Aww.
Oh, I fell.
See, that's the problem if you don't.
It's
a pretty,
It's pretty tight to get up there with gravity, so sometimes I will miss it.
Yeah.
It's not the end of the world. Luckily, there are, in this game, because we've tried to optimize as much as possible, but there are some areas where you can lose time, so losing 1 or 2 seconds isn't the end of the run until we get our run down to, like, ridiculous levels.
Yeah, and this game's pretty new as far as running goes. There hasn't been... I mean, we've done the routing that we can, but there's still so much more to be figured out with this game. It has a lot of places it can be improved, definitely. So in this mission, we're just trying to get through and replace this gem, this like star gem, because someone's trying to steal it, and the cops are like on high alert, so we're trying to sneak around them, which is why we couldn't go just directly up to the location, because you'll see the alert level, we have to make sure that we don't get caught by the police that are standing there, like that guy. And so, if the alert level reaches 100, then you have to, like, start back from a little bit. You get set back. So we go around and collect these gems, and now we have our first upgrade where we upgrade gauge usage. Our first non-scripted upgrade.
So this game tries to vary up its gameplay, so it's not just run around, find Nevi, which are the enemies, kick their butts, move on to the next area, you know, like sort of like Zelda. It wants to be unique, it wants to have variety, and so there are these little areas where you got stuff like a alert level, which you gotta avoid getting caught. This only appears once in the game.
Mm-hmm. So there's another one of those cutscene skips.
And there's even a special tutorial for the boss, believe it or not. For the final boss of the game. Oh, hey, I got that. not think I got that one.
Nice. Okay, so here we throw these stasis objects at these enemies, because it's easier, and you don't have a lot of gravity meter right now, so stasis objects take less gravity meter for the damage that they do over, like, gravity kicking, which is later in the game we'll be using a lot more. Oh, that one was unfortunate. But of course the objects just love going into pillars, and we've kind of created a tier list of objects, because the larger the objects, the more easily they will just collide into something and crash and, like, not hit the thing that you want them to hit. And these upcoming Nebbi, the ones that are flying around, these, we just call them flyers. They can be pretty annoying, but usually we take care of them with stasis objects throughout the game. But when it comes to flying enemies, they can just move and get out of the way, and sometimes the objects will follow them, sometimes they don't. It kind of depends on how the game's feeling, I guess. So yeah, this is a pretty straightforward site, just this fight, just because there's so many objects in the area, you just kind of run around, pick them up, and chuck them at everybody, and then try to get it done as fast as possible.
So, on that that enemy I'm shooting at right now, we call it a snail. On its back, there's a bone shell. I'm just gonna finish it off with a kick. There you go. So, on its back is a bone shell. Now, these bones have an interesting property in which, if you were to go up to them and hit them normally, they have, like, I wouldn't say a health gauge, but they have a hidden health gauge. Which will be depleted as you kick them, but they are also get destroyed. They will get destroyed instantly by certain attacks. Those attacks being specials and gravity kick. Stasis objects.
So stasis objects are really helpful, and sometimes the game just doesn't want you to start a freaking mission.
I hit circle by mistake. Sorry.
That's okay. That happens. So this is we call this the white flyer. And this is just following this pigeon, but this pigeon is really slow. So there's one checkpoint we have to reach before it triggers the point to the end. So what we do is we take the time, because we have the spare time, to grab this gem right here. And then we go over to the corner where we're going to meet this and grab another gem. But if we get too far out of the range of the flyer, it'll say we lost him, even if we know exactly where he's going. So we try to collect. We only really get the opportunity to grab 20 gems here while we're waiting on it. But yeah, so it's gonna meet us down here.
Yeah, that's it. There's a few of these sections where we have to wait. Not too many, luckily. Mm-hmm. And thankfully, during most of them, we can make up for that time by collecting more gems. More gems means more things we can upgrade. And now, we mentioned four upgrades in particular, but there's one additional upgrade which we will be using, which is the health upgrade.
Oh,
now,
of course.
Going through the whole game without any health upgrades is possible. But later in the game, enemies will one-shot you, and there's not much chance I'm not a robot. I'm not going to be able to get through the game perfectly, maybe without getting hit. Sometimes I get really far, and I'm like, oh, hey, I should upgrade this before I get to enemies that can one-shot me at basic health.
Yeah, and of course, one of the nice things about this is when you upgrade health, it counts as, like, a free health potion, so it fully heals you and gives you the extra health. So it can be really nice, like, if you take damage and you're getting low, to just, you know, throw the gems in and upgrade your health and get a bunch of bonus health. And there's a few, we pretty much don't upgrade health at least until about the halfway point of the game, because usually the first part of the game it's not very brutal or anything. Frickin' airships getting in the way. So it's we wait until about the halfway point until we throw in some upgrades, because that's when the enemies start getting pretty dangerous.
Alright, and this section here I like, because this is where we can get to explain gravity sliding. There's a lot of this in this game. We're going to try to go through it as quick as possible, but there is going to be a rather large section in the game which we'll be able to explain things.
Oh my gosh, the connection's just messing up. Anyway, so yeah, we're getting to, we're gonna gravity slide in a little bit, but it's a nice little thing that we used it, like, very few points in the game, because it's not faster, like, gravity kicking is the fastest method of movement, but gravity sliding can be really fun, and the reason why we use it here is because of all these walls. If we were to try to kick into each wall, and it would waste time, so gravity sliding is just the most consistent strategy to get through this little hallway. This upcoming part is a strange, like, Dusty's trying to run away from us, so we lose our gravity powers, and then a bunch of random enemies spawn out of nowhere. And what's nice, though, is Cat has, when she doesn't have gravity powers, has really high jumps, so we can jump over a pretty good like amount of these ledges.
Yeah, it's really nice for platforming. It's not Mario by any chance, but it's
definitely
not. But there's no wall. Actually, well, I can't say there's no wall jumping. There, it kind of is, but I'm not yet. Not yet. Let's just say not yet. Oh, they all want me. Oh, yeah. This guy wants me too.
This guy's annoying.
He has a large tail that will hit you larger range than you would expect. Sort of like Monster Hunter Freedom Unite. Let's see. What else can we talk about? Combat.
Upcoming. This is what I would consider kind of the first like really combat heavy like part.
Yeah, is it the first dungeon of the game?
Yeah, more or less. It's kind of the first dungeon. It's what it's called as a rift plane, in which we fight nevies and these flower things shoot laser beams and stuff. It's pretty cool. And we basically have to like return another part of the town because each part of this town has been like separated, and there's 4 towns in the game, and we're about to get to the second one.
That lamppost, man, it was, I don't know how it was in my way, but it was in my way.
Yeah, that just, sometimes that can happen. Like we said, lots of movement optimization that can happen in this game that makes it really interesting. So here we have the first upcoming fight.
My strategy is like, grab this block, shift up, hit this guy. Now, these frogs, while they are probably the third worst enemy in the game, in terms of being random, they can be manipulated. For example, every time they get hit, they will always turn 180 degrees. So that's a constant thing. But when you leave them to their own devices, you know, wander around, they do whatever the heck they want. They don't have any patterns. There are other enemies that are worse. They're both flying enemies, and when we get to them, we'll explain them. Alright.
So here we pick up this rock. This pillar is has three gems, and it has three weak points.
Cores.
Cores. And they each, and then of course the bone shell, and that spits out. Actually, it spits the smaller enemies. They're called R's. It spits those out, and whatever R's it spits out don't count towards the flower completion, which is why we left that guy there and why he didn't count. We beat him. So here we gotta take care of these enemies on the ground, and then we got this frog and the R that's up on the wall over here. So grab an object to make it a little bit easier.
Frog is still facing me. I have to wait for the frog to go away. Alright, so the frog just wants to...
He just wants some love. There we
I'm
go.
Grab the frog,
gonna grab this, that gem, grab the blue gem.
Just for safety.
Yeah, because sometimes you can, depending on how optimal your movement is, you can lose some gems that you might have picked up in a different place, so we try to make sure we reach, like, a certain gem count at certain points. So here we got 4 enemies, 2 flyers, and then 2 R's that are up on that really high ceiling. And throwing these objects is really nice because it just auto-targets them and they fly pretty much a long distance, so...
16 no-scope, man.
Yeah. So we grab this 25, and now we're getting to the point where we reach our first tree, and each tree in the game gives you like a new special power. So this first one we'll be getting is called Spiral Claw, and special abilities are activated by pressing the triangle button with some sort of directional input, but the first one that you get is just neutral triangle. Right now we upgrade gauge usage and stasis field. Upgrading gauge usage, we've explained, and then upgrading stasis field allows us to pick up one more object. So now we can pick up both of these rocks instead of having to pick them up one at a time. And we can throw them at these flyers and makes it a little bit easier.
If the flyers want to face me.
If they want to cooperate, because sometimes they just don't.
Usually they're pretty cooperative, and those are there's only 3 flyers in the game that can really annoy me.
Yeah, that happens. So here, stasis field is a super crucial part of this,
at the beginning of the game.
Later
in the game, enemies will get tougher, and this
There'll be less objects around to throw as well.
Especially during the ascent.
Yeah. So, yeah, in some cases, no objects. So we go in here because we want to collect these 25 gems, and the game's going to auto-teleport us in a second. And so here what we need to do, because we don't have as many gems to hit the threshold we want, is they place groups of 40 gems, and we grab these gems because we want to upgrade Gravity Kick right before we reach the boss, because Gravity Kick helps put out a lot more damage on the boss and helps just general everything in the game. It makes the movement of the gravity kick faster, and it just makes it way more powerful.
You know, I just realized we never discussed the most important technique in the game. I'm just gonna grab these.
Yeah.
Steve, could you explain rapid gravity kicks?
All right. So rapid gravity kicks is something that we discovered while routing out this game. That has to do with basically when you gravity kick, you'll notice that if you bounce off something, there's a certain kind of like amount of recoil. But what we do here, like that, and then what we can do here is cancel the gravity and reactivate it in gravity kick to rapidly kick over and over and output a lot more damage in a much shorter amount of time. And so here you'll see he gravity kicks 5 times, and then we use spiral claw for the finisher, because you have to press triangle to finish the boss, and that's just a quick, easy way to get it done. And that's the strategy we use for the first few bosses.
If I use spiral claw, lines my camera up perfectly so I can just mash triangle.
And then we can finish
this. And so yeah, rapid gravity kicks. They make a lot of enemies much faster to kill. Makes the game a lot smoother to watch, a lot more optimal, but at the same time, some enemies have invincibility frames, so you gotta be careful. If you try to rapid gravity kick them, you'll end up just hitting your invincibility frames.
And it's really nice too, because the game, and sometimes the game's auto-targeting just doesn't cooperate, because that's what basically when
it's
you kick...
It's like the best auto-targeting in the world, where you just like, oh my goodness, like some enemy, sometimes you'll throw an object, enemy will fly off screen or even teleport, and the object's like, nope, I was aiming for you. And
yeah, I'm gonna get you.
It'll just go where they teleported. I've seen them do it. I've seen enemies do a huge dive bomb, and the object just follows them. Now objects, a stasis object, and the gravity kick both follow this principle, so they will both end up doing that. All right. Now Steve, I'd like to explain something to you that I figured out.
Mm-hmm.
So when this game was localized to the Western version, whatever reason, Japan has circles except X has, and X has, you know, go back. Mm-hmm. In everywhere else, it's the opposite way around, where X is except and circles go back. So what I found out they did was they just went through the code and switched every instance of using circle with
Oh, with that's why. Okay, that makes sense for the positioning of these on this quiz.
Yeah.
Granted, that's not a big part of the game. That's not a big part of the game, but thank God, because that would be really annoying. So what sucks about that quiz sometimes is you'll see the bottom one, you'll be like, oh, it's the bottom option, it must be on X, but no, it's on circle, and then X is where circle should be.
On the Japanese version, I know this because I was watching Japanese one of the Japanese speedrunners do this, and he had circle, which... circle for accept is much more convenient, because whenever you try to go accept a mission or something, the mission, even though it gives you the prompt, will not actually appear right away. So you go to push X, and instead of accept mission, you end up jumping. If you were able to use circle, you'd end up using stasis field, which is much nicer.
Yeah, it's shorter if you mess up. But what we also can do sometimes is, like, because you can't jump while you kick, but you can accept missions, we'll just throw out a kick so that we can accept missions without accidentally jumping. There was one of those, game can punish you for mashing because trying to skip scenes.
Yeah. I've been known to mash a few times.
Yeah.
Up for the holder here.
Alright, so this is what we call, the whole Newt world. which is where we take Newt around the campus, and it's a beautiful...
It's a romantic scene with Cat, because Cat has a crush on Newt.
Yeah, and it's where we're taking him on a magic gravity ride around the city. And it's even cute. They put little the gems over here, once you get to the next part. They're in a little heart shape, because they love each other. See, right there. Isn't that cute? Well, yeah, it's a one-way street, but, you know... I guess a girl can dream. This is pretty much a straightforward part. And
Cat can dream alright. She does a lot of dreaming.
this is true. So now we're about to reach the second boss, which we call the spider boss.
It's
Kusiko. Have it in the splits, don't actually know how to pronounce it. So basically, this boss is mostly like an auto scroll. It's kind of like an auto scroller that once you defeat all the gems on its back, you have to meet it at certain checkpoints. So we're gonna just try to, you know, kick it as fast as possible. And like right here, we use Spiral Claw because she stops at this point, and it allows us to kind of catch up because she runs really fast, and Spiral Claw can be pretty nice for killing those gems. This infestation level at the top right isn't really, like, that important, but, like, if you hit Echo, who's the person that's at the front, on accident, then it increases the infestation level. So, once he finishes these last gems, there's a few, or these last cores, there's a few gems we're gonna collect so that we can have a little bit extra for upgrading purposes, because there's no time save we can get here. And once all the gems are done, when she reaches those checkpoints, you have to kick her so that she just moves on. Just be like, hey, shoo, get on.
Yeah, otherwise, Mystica will just sit there, and it's really annoying. I don't understand why. You could be standing right next to Mystica, and she'll just like, hey, what's up? So one use of using the Spiral Claw there earlier was that it has a constant hitbox, which any hitbox will push Kasiko. This spider boss is, right now, it's essentially an auto-scroller, so I have time to go collect these gems.
Yeah,
there is an auto-scroll in this game, there aren't too many, luckily, but anytime there are, I go around collecting gems after I've done whatever the auto-scroller wants me to do, like, go to a checkpoint or something.
Yeah, so it's really nice, we actually sometimes are like, there's one point where we're kind of like, thank God there's an auto-scroller, which is not a very common speedrunning thing. But it allows us to collect a whole bunch of gems for upgrades, which is really nice and helps speed up other parts of the game. So here again, we're using the rapid gravity kicks, and then we use the spiral claw so we can mash triangle, which makes it really nice. And then up and coming, we'll be having the second rift, so we can go to the third city, because we gotta save the town.
You see that, Steve? That airship just decided to appear right there.
Yeah, I know. They just want to get in your way.
In the game, which will almost never play a role, sometimes airships can get in your way. I mean, but you know, 3D movement, obviously we can go around it.
Not too much of a time loss, but inconvenient.
Here comes gravity sliding.
Yeah,
like
this is
gravity
the first.
Sliding. This is one of the few parts where we will use it, because it is. It might not necessarily be faster, but it's definitely more consistent.
Yeah, you won't accidentally kick into the ground, because we need to collect all of these gems to hit the thresholds for the gem upgrades that we need, and like just sliding is just so much more consistent. You can also jump out of sliding like we're doing here just by pressing X, and so we gotta make sure we collect all these gems along this path, and if we were trying to gravity shift through them and we accidentally fell or something got messed up, it would be a big time waste, so we keep this up for consistency's sake.
So frog is the most annoying enemy here. I will get rid of it first with the spiral claw, and then whatever else spiral claw decides to give me, I will take.
Yeah.
That is the general strategy for this area. The other two enemies are not a problem. Oop. Oh, he even came right to me to say hi.
Oh yeah.
Again.
Something else we wanted to note: if you either, when it comes to stasis objects, if you either take damage or your gravity meter depletes fully, then you will drop the objects that you hold, so that will... you drop everything that you hold, so we just try to make sure that... And there's a few places where objects are really important, and we're like, we're not gonna try to... We just gotta be super safe, because if you drop them, it's a big time loss. So here we're just going along the path, getting the blue gems to refill the gravity meter, and making sure we collect all these gems. And then we're gonna upgrade Gravity Kick again, which is gonna... It costs 600. Gravity Kick is by far the most expensive thing, but also the most useful, so we still get it.
There's only four upgrades, unfortunately. If there was more, we would get them, and believe me, every time you upgrade it, it upgrades not only your damage output, it upgrades, quote-unquote, the performance, which includes the movement, so it goes faster.
Which, of course, is always nice. So this enemy right here, which is what we call the swordfish.
They are the only enemy in the game which will actively dodge you. Every other enemy in the game has the sense to just take it. They know they're dead. They see cat, they know it, but swordfish, no. You come at this swordfish is like, nope, and they will parry you and then counter. So you can swordfish, one really consistent way is just to lure them out, and then you can hit them and they won't dodge you. Right here, I've done all the tricky part that the sliding would help with, so I just kick the rest of the way, because sliding is very, very slow.
Alright. So upcoming, we have this battle. These are the big golems. We call them the golems, and they have a lot of gems, and they do this AoE attack like that, where they just try to push you off. And they have another attack, which we usually don't encounter very often, but he does a really big punch at you. And so upcoming here on this tree is the, is where we get our second and most useful special ability called Gravity Typhoon, if you want to explain that, Max.
Oh my goodness, it's so useful that we're just gonna upgrade it right now.
It's basically...
Right now, so it is... So what it does is it essentially free stasis objects whenever you want. Now, stasis objects, I've already explained, are pretty good. But, yeah, so let's watch this. So I could go around kicking all these enemies, or I could just do this, and I just stand around here and watch the show. So that is... That saves a
probably
lot of time in certain fights. It saves so much time, in fact, that I will actually be using stasis, I will be actually be using the, so whenever you use a special, it has a timer until the special gauge comes back. Every single special has a different gauge, with Spiral Claw being the shortest. Now for, this one, it's about, right now it's about a minute and, 20 seconds until it comes back. Which, you know, I mean, that's not too long a time. But, The route is routed out so that I will be... When I need it next, I get it next.
Alright, so now we have the next boss fight, and this is your quote-unquote rival in the game, kind of the other gravity shifter. Her name is Raven. And this is one of the most annoying fights in the game, because she flies around and just... has, like, as soon as you gravity kick her while she's in those flying animations, she has invincibility frames, and you have to wait it out. And it just, she'll randomly go places, she'll do the different attacks, and sometimes she just, your auto-targeting doesn't cooperate, other times it does. It's kind of one of the biggest fights where there can be a lot of time loss because of how she decides to just, if she decides to be nice or not. But pretty much we wait, see, like, she'll just randomly... Like, she'll stop somewhere and then fly, or she'll stop somewhere and attack you. And so we wait with Gravity Typhoons on about
right,
1 minute 20 second
stuck.
Timers. Yeah, she can get stuck in the lava. It doesn't seem like she's moving at all. Got one more. And then we'll be good. And then we gotta meet her. She just flies up here, and we meet her right in the middle of this Ferris wheel. And then... There we go, that was Raven. That was a pretty good Raven. She was pretty nice. Didn't seem
yeah,
too
well,
trolly.
Usually I expect to get beat her before I get back gauge. If I get back gauge, that means I get to use Gravity Typhoon, which, you know, doesn't waste too much time.
Mm-hmm.
Gravity Typhoon and Spiral Claw are both very effective against her. Mm-hmm. Later on in the game, we will be using Spiral Claw as much, but Gravity Typhoon everywhere. And then the third upgrade, which we'll be getting at the next Rift Plane, coming up. All right, so right now, all I'm doing is just going around, doing tasks. I could explain all of them, like collecting the bomb is kind of random and other stuff, but I think the most important thing to explain is the next boss coming up, because that is our favorite boss, isn't that, Steve?
Totally! This is the best boss. No, the upcoming boss is a guy named Alias, who's kind of a, like, I don't know, vigilante who's trying to collect these sacred gems and things. He was referenced in the first when we had that fish statue. He was a part of that, but we didn't really show him because we skipped all the scenes. And so up and coming, we will be fighting him, and he was a real pain when it came to routing.
He's not finished, Steve.
Yeah, he's still not finished.
What I say. He is not a finished boss. They've polished a lot of this game, but they did not finish. Someone missed the memo.
Yeah, so he basically has, like, random, kind of, if you hit him or not, it just feels, like, really annoying, and if it wasn't for rapid gravity kicking, he would be significantly more annoying. And so, I mean, we'll see when we get there, but we actually have to, we collect enough gems and waste a few seconds here and there just to upgrade Gravity Typhoon, because it's, because he's that annoying, and Gravity Typhoon gives us that little extra bit of damage we need.
Alright, here comes the can. Hope for can. Come on, can.
Alright, we gotta get that can. The top tier of objects.
Did I get it? Oh,
nah.
No, it's down there. I should destroy the box just to be sure.
So this is a pretty straightforward fight.
In this fight, we just use Gravity Typhoon and clears out this first wave. And then there's three more of these flies around for the next wave. And then just go one, 2. Okay.
Boom. Easy. Oh, I forgot to split. Dang it. When you disarm the bomb. Okay, so now we have to rescue these police officers that the Nevi took and dropped off on different random towers. Pretty straightforward. The only thing we do is during the on the way back from the second officer, we pick up there's some gems that are nice and in our way, and we really need to hit that 400 gem mark right before the alias fight happens for the Gravity Typhoon upgrade, so that helps with that.
I'd like to, as much as I love to talk about police officers, they're really boring. Back to Alias, because Alias is honestly it's not my favorite boss. We don't like it, but he is very random. He has sporadic patterns. At the very beginning, he usually, I like to stress this, usually will start shooting balls in the air, and it's a really nice attack because we can just wail on him with our newly upgraded Gravity Typhoon. But sometimes he'll just be like, okay, I'm out of here, and he'll teleport, or he'll just jump to the next platform, but this is, like, rare, you know, and but we have no control, we do not know how it's gonna happen, we have limited manipulation.
Yeah.
By standing still at the beginning of the fight, he will usually do that, the attack we want. Right now we're doing a bunch of little Nevi fights, before him, then we'll upgrade Gravity Typhoon, and then fight him.
And what's nice about these Nevi fights is you, again, don't need to clear out every Nevi, just actually a select few. Kind of the ones that, when he disappears and the Nevi appear, those are the ones that you pretty much need to kill. Like these ones right here, we don't need to worry about, but we've got time to kill, so. Alright,
okay,
so you need to beat this frog and these two R's in order to progress this part, but those pillars you don't need to worry about.
They're flowers.
The flowers, that's right. The
you
pillars are the other ones. I know.
Alright, here we go. More flower. I'm just gonna give this flower just because I have time and I'm bored. So here comes Alias. I summons two snails. So these things. I use these objects, like I said earlier. Using objects will instantly destroy bones.
So it's very helpful on the bone enemies.
And some bones are actually stronger than others, but they all get destroyed in one hit by any stasis object.
So here we decide to go around here because, like we said, we need to hit that 400 threshold, which we got, even though it takes a little bit extra time, because that's how we get that Gravity Typhoon upgrade. So here it's just pretty straightforward, killing all the R's. The ones that have orange gems have more health. It's kind of like a level 2 or orange cores. Man, I need to get those words right. They have like double the health, so they take two gravity kicks instead of one to beat. And so here we upgrade Gravity Typhoon. Gotta make sure we can do that.
I also upgraded the time thing because I found that it actually makes a little bit of a difference, in particular on the final Nushi, which we'll get to much later in this game. It was actually really helpful to have on that because just consistency.
And that was the only, that pillar that he summoned was the only one that you needed to defeat to actually progress in the game. So this is the fun alien boss, Alias boss, the dragon head.
Yes,
he's cooperating right now. So we break these bones, and then if done correctly, then we should only need one gravity kick for each head to break them. But of course, is it gonna work? Oh, no. The auto-targeting on this boss is worse than almost anything else in this game. We need to wait.
What's he gonna do?
Alright, so he's not gonna... He can teleport away, he can spin around, he can do a whole mess of things that just suck. Alright, that was...
He's down, he's dead.
So now he goes down, and this is where rapid gravity kicking really comes in handy. It allows us to one-cycle him really fast.
So even with level 1 gravity kick, it takes 14 hits, and yes, those go really quickly on him. So yeah, I tried it out with it is hilarious to watch, because it's like, well on him way more than necessary. poor Alias.
Yeah, you gotta do what you gotta do. So now the game teleports us back to our house, which is annoying.
And this is why we need to collect the manhole we did earlier. There are three manholes, plus your house, that are mandatory to collect. One is given to you at the start of the third chapter. This one we had to collect earlier, and then we'll have to collect one more in the fourth city. You know what, Steve? I'm gonna have to ask you to remind me to grab it. I'm not sure if I'll remember.
All right. Yeah. I got you. Okay, so here what we do is we actually decide to go over those buildings and collect those gems because we're waiting for this first wave that's coming up in this rift plane. We're waiting on Gravity Typhoon to come back up, and because of how fast the alias fight goes, it barely comes back up at times, so we're like, okay, we'll just waste a teeny bit of time, grab some more gems, because it makes this fight a lot faster, and it allows us to kind of use that time a little bit more effectively.
Yeah, they would not. If you were to try to fight it normally, the gravity gauge, this thing would come back up in time, and so you're not really saving time.
There it is.
Alright.
So here we go. This, the Gravity Typhoon just helps take care of this wave really fast. Because in this rift plane, Dusty is sick, as you saw in that previous cutscene. So your gravity meter is significantly reduced. And no matter how many points you put into gauge usage or recovery time, it's always static in this place. So, because...
It adds variety. They wanted to. So what they've done is they've minimized your gravity, amount of gravity gauge you have, and maximized its recovery. Can I get this guy in time? Yeah. All right.
Yeah, so gravity kicks and things like that are a lot more difficult to execute because you need to be really close and you can't. Rapid gravity kicking is a lot more difficult. So these spiky balls are relatively annoying enemies that are basically invulnerable, and you have to kind of pull aggro on them so that they like retract and then they expose their cores so we can defeat them.
I'm not following this path well. So like I said, your gravity gauge does not last long, but you can follow this path. And then I'm gonna go up here, I'm gonna grab these. And then I come down here. And... one, two... one... If I was too... well, what's going on? Okay, I got both of them. If I was too slow, I wouldn't be doing this. I would just be using... I'm gonna save it, because...
Yeah, these long leg, enemies can be really annoying, especially when you don't easily have the gravity meter to reach them. So that can be a really annoying and challenging fight in this place. So right here, we're gonna kick right down these rows of 25s, and then we're gonna fall and grab these three as on our way up.
You're
to getting
supposed
this
to have
tree.
Been one underneath me. Did I grab it? Alright, so this is the third upgrade. So we used to not get this at a very early time when we were still routing this game. We didn't think it was useful. And then we found out it was very useful.
Yeah, but only in very few places against really specific bosses. And it's not overall. Gravity Typhoon is by far the most versatile and useful special in the game. But Micro Black Hole, for some reason, it just does really well against very specific bosses that we will explain when it comes. So this fight, Spiral Claw helps take him out, and it allows you to kind of throw out more hitboxes with less gravity usage because specials don't use the same amount. They use a separate meter than the regular gravity meter. And upcoming, we call this Wallflower. Its real name is Lagon. And it has basically this little tower has mini wallflowers that you have to beat for the final boss to open up. So we have to gravity kick each one of these. It takes two gravity kicks per, and you can rapid gravity cancel, which is pretty sweet. So they are invulnerable when they kind of pull back to do that shooting attack. You can't hit the core, so that can be a little bit annoying if you don't time it correctly. Right here, we're gonna jump off, take care of this guy real fast.
And then I'm gonna wait here for a moment because it's about to close.
Yep.
I won't be able to get both out in time. Then I go up here, I got this gem. I'm gonna wait here for just a moment because my gravity gauge hasn't quite come back yet.
Oh. And now that we have it, this is where we first use Micro Black Hole.
And it just shreds this boss. Oh. Yeah, there we go. So, as you can see, it is, like, before I could go and rapid gravity kick it, it's not too slow, but then using that there shreds it. And because that boss was so entertaining the first time, they decided to put it in a second time right afterwards.
Yay. So yeah, as soon as we leave the rift plane, I guess the Nevi followed us out and is now taking over the big tower in the middle of the city.
So, Steve, would you like to explain what I'm doing right here?
Yes, this right now is another auto-scroller section. It's 1 minute and 20 seconds. And basically at 1 minute, Sid, well, the one of our helper police guys is gonna give us a call, and that will be like a short indicator. But basically, no matter what we do, we can't like, if we try to fight the boss, it won't help or anything like that. So we're just gonna use this time to collect as many gems as possible, which is really nice because that'll give us the 1,000 that we need to get that last gravity kick upgrade, and it'll give us enough for gauge usage and for other things earlier in the game so that we can, you know, get through other parts of the game faster. So this auto-scroller is actually pretty beneficial since there's a whole ton of gems that we can collect in the immediate area.
Approximately 7 plus. Now, there's only one condition, which is I do not fall. So if I fall down, I'll get sent back to where I started this auto-scroller. That is really useful, actually. I'm about to abuse it, but I have to wait for that, because if I don't, then it will actually increase the amount of time. I don't understand why that is, but once that cutscene happens, there's like another timer that starts.
But yeah, we use the really quick reset so that we can collect, because there's a lot of gems up this tower, and there's 425 gems on the top of the tower. So we use that reset to grab these last few gems right before the cutscene happens. We upgrade gravity kick.
Yeah, I'm gonna upgrade kick. So there we go. That was the final upgrade to gravity kick. There's only 4, but now it's maximum, and that means I'll be doing maximum amount of damage, which is very beneficial.
Yes, super beneficial. And we have the maximum amount of speed of the kick, like as far as distance traveling goes, which in the upcoming segment we will be traveling a lot.
So there is actually another upgrade. It's called full speed, which you think, oh yeah, full speed, right? Speedrun. Yeah, that only gets faster than gravity kick at like level like 10. And we don't have time to get that.
We don't even have the option to get level 10, because we don't do the side quests to get more. Because this game has reputations that Cat gets by completing little challenges and doing little things around the city.
Increase reputation in every mission, too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the story missions do it as well, but basically we don't max out our reputation because we don't want to do any of the side things in an any percent run. And, so for that reason, this is another point in which micro black hole.
Oh, it's not working.
Oh, we didn't get the fast kill.
Sometimes it doesn't work, but luckily there's backup.
Rapid gravity kicks are very effective. They're the tried and true. So we don't get any further upgrade ability within the run. We don't further upgrade kicks. We don't further upgrade, No, I think that's the only one so far.
Right now what we're about to do is we're about to restart shareplay. I'll explain it after I do it. Alright, I'm gonna go redo it right now.
Okay.
During this cutscene.
So this cutscene will progress even if we don't, and we have to do shareplay because he doesn't have the recording equipment, but I do. So we can do this.
We probably should explain that at the beginning, but
yeah.
There's a lot to explain. Okay, SharePlay has started again. I'm going back in there.
And SharePlay has an hour time limit, but luckily we can get it within that.
Steve, thank you for. I guess right now you don't need to remind me to get that manhole over here, Gade is reminding us.
Mm-hmm. Sadly.
So Gade points you over to him because you'll need this manhole to get back to him later.
Gade, of course, being that weird old guy that's always there when we go to a new rift.
He doesn't appreciate being called weird, Steve.
I mean, come on. He's pretty weird.
I mean, he is a traitor, that's all. Oh,
man. So now we're at the, now we're more or less at the, halfway point of the game.
Yeah.
Which is, this is what we call the descent.
So this whole city, you go to city, go to rift, blah, blah, blah. You have this entire city to go explore. It's huge. It's the one that's on the cover art. And where does Cat decide she wants to start exploring? Let's check the bottom of this pillar. I don't understand this logic here. That city is wonderful. It is beautiful. I'm going to look back up on it and see. Look how magnificent it would be. Let's go explore that city.
Has
right
a
now.
Really cool clock tower and all this fun stuff. And the first thing we're gonna do is leave.
Just leave. So this is the part where we would have a lot of donations. But since we don't have time for that, we'll use this time to explain a bunch of things we weren't able to explain earlier. There's a lot of explaining. But right now I want to explain movement. So there are different types of movement. My favorite, the most fastest type of movement is what I'm doing right now, which is gravity kicking. I can also do gravity shifting like this, which I have more control over, Cat, and it the slower the movement, the less gravity it uses of the game. So I could go much farther with gravity shifting normally than I could with gravity kicks. However, I want to go fast.
And this is is a segment right now where we went through this little like wall, and now we can't use gravity anymore. So we basically just fall for the entirety of these 600
skydiving, huh?
Yeah, pretty much. And there's a little tech that we have in this part that's nice. It's called evade canceling, or like landing lag, because when you fall a certain amount of distance, when you reach a threshold, Cat will hit the ground and like crash, and she'll have a sort of crashing like animation where she has to get up. But if you have the evade button, which is R2 plus any direction, which is how we do like a roll, which we very rarely use in the run, but that for example was the crash, and you can cancel that crash by basically spamming the evade button right before you hit the ground.
And so during these fall sections, since we have nothing better to do, we just collect these gems. No matter how, as long as you move towards the exit at the end, you're not wasting time.
Yeah, you're fine. So then now when we reach this other threshold, we will have regained gravity power.
Let's go back to shifting. Alright, so if I take another hit, I'm going to quickly heal up. Use my my health potion.
Yes,
my health potion, essentially.
The health upgrade potions.
Yeah, those are really nice to have in the run.
And this
really
is the
any time just to heal yourself.
This is the first point in the game where just the pacing kind of significantly slows down, and like there's no real way to speed this up because you just gotta get there, which is sad. And there's not a lot of interesting things. I mean, there's a lot of enemies and there's more gems we can collect, but we just skip it because gotta go fast. So here we're gonna reach another. Yet another descent part. Reach this threshold and then whee.
Yeah, usually I'm supposed to kick through it, but I ran out of gravity.
Just getting
a little bit early.
Health,
yeah. So yeah, I grab that health. If I can hit again, I'm just gonna upgrade.
The threshold we need to reach by the time, which usually isn't too difficult, but the threshold we wanna reach before the next big fight that we have. The next big, like, Nevi fight is going to be a gravity
Nevi
typhoon.
Fight, which, Steve, there is
well, yeah,
a much
no.
more important fight.
No, of course, there's Nevi an upcoming, fight. there's an upcoming rather annoying, in fact, really annoying fight with, our buddy old pal Raven, who just, as a character, is one of the coolest characters in the game, but as a boss, is the most annoying with her two forms, I guess, if you want to call it that. And what we have upcoming is the Falling Raven fight, where we...
Falling Raven fight is just what it says. We're doing exactly what we're doing here, with gravity powers, but we have to get past Raven.
Yeah.
Fantastic level design, I have to say. I have to applaud the guy who came up with this. It's a variety of events. It's a nice way to add variety. Unfortunately for speedrun, not so nice, because she's random, she does whatever she does. Sometimes you can have a really good Raven, other times you can have a really bad Raven.
Just depends on her pattern.
Yeah. Anyway. She has a bunch of things she can do. She can throw these big blue balls, which will teleport you back to the top, and then she'll throw these little ones, which are nearly impossible to avoid. Basically, it almost guarantees you that you'll have to upgrade your
health
at least
yeah.
twice during that fight.
Yeah, and then she has she has another thing where she throws kind of a bigger rock at you, but basically, the pattern is really annoying, and there's no real way to speed it up because it's not like you're trying to deplete her health bar or anything. You just literally have to reach the end, and she's just there trying to stop you.
And that's Raven. There's not much more to explain. Afterwards, there's a large fight, which is really annoying to optimize because it's at the end of this large descent, and there is no way to save for this fight. But, yeah, there's that fight, and then there's Chapter 14, which is another thing that we'll have to explain.
Oh, yay, Chapter 14. like we said, this part of the game, just not a lot of interesting things going on, not a lot of strats, just get to the place. But we're about to start the Falling Raven fight.
Alright, so bit of serious time right now. Let me just concentrate for this. Alright.
golden.
Okay, Steve, explain just what happened.
Okay, so the beautiful thing about this design is that the pillars at the very point that we discovered right near the top, the reason why we go up instead of down is because she can get stuck, and that's really nice. Doesn't speed up the fight, but it also makes the fight a million times less annoying, because now she's just stuck inside of that pillar. It's as you basically get inside that little crevice in that pillar at that location, she comes underneath you to try to attack you, and then she gets caught in between the pillar and the wall, almost like stuck inside of the pillar. And so as long as we stay on this left side of the pillar, because she can't escape out the left side, then she's just gonna stay there, and we don't have to worry about her. But if she would...
There's two ways we could do this fight. We either... get between this wall here and the outside, which is possible. We've done it before. We don't understand how we did it, but we did it. Or you can get her stuck. So in this version, one difference between this version and the Vita version, which came before, is that they changed this area, the level design for this area, just this one. No other area has been changed. That's because in the Vita version there was just a hole in the geometry. Not a visible hole, but like you could just walk through it and you could get outside. So if you were doing this run on the Vita version, you couldn't get her stuck in the same way, but you could just get outside the geometry and then just fall to the bottom, and you have the wall protecting you from Raven.
So at least,
which is really nice.
Yeah, of course. So the most annoying fight in this has become significantly less annoying, but of course, a lot more boring, because now we're just falling and falling, and we can't speed this up.
This is basically what we would call a very, very good time for donations. Steve, would you like to read off some donations?
Of course, we got $5. No. Oh, it's great to see you guys break this game. I loved it when I first played it. I never thought it could be played like this. Thanks so much. This goes to Runner's Choice. No.
Runner's Choice, by the way, is either gonna be save the animals or kill the animals, depending on what I feel like that day. Mm-hmm. Or if you guys have a really good file name choice, hopefully there's one that I can name Cat, because you know that's name this character.
With a K.
Yeah,
with
K.
Just to point out.
For Chrono Trigger, what's her name? Bulma. Or Bulma, but she's not actually Bulma. I want to name her Cat. You know, in Chrono Trigger, the tech girl, I keep forgetting her actual name. I want to call her Bulma, because that's essentially the character she is. Alright, and now we're at the end of this thing.
Alright,
and so after this long, tiring fight, the game decides that you need a break. And so it gives you a break. So, in the best way possible, puts Cat in a cage. This is basically where you go on bathroom break.
But this is the most fun part, because you can run around and jump during the cutscene. Whee! This is the most important move tech in the game, in case it wasn't obvious. Like, this is RNG manipulation at its finest. No. Just waiting.
So no matter what I do in this cage, I can't get out, clearly. Jumping has no effect, kicking has no effect, and Dusty's not here, and when Dusty's not here, I can't shift gravity. So, obviously, there's no way out of this cage, right? So I just have to wait for this little girl to come let me out, right? Or... using this little glitch, using a glitch in the system.
For some reason,
if you keep jumping, it'll eventually let you out, as per instructed in the game. Alright, and so now I'm gonna concentrate for this part. This is, if I go fast enough, I can one-cycle these guards up ahead.
Okay, I'll explain this. So basically, again, when we don't have gravity powers, chances are we're gonna find Dusty. So this little segment is just kind of a mini platforming segment, and these guards that these little boys over here, like this guy, he's turned around right now, but we have to make sure that we don't get these guards. And there's very minor skips that are in this, like you'll see it up with this ledge hop, where if you push yourself against the wall, you don't have to ledge grab these ledges like you will here, because it doesn't work with that wall. But those little minor things allow us to one cycle the guards. Which is really nice. And, so
Not for that first one I did, they weren't essential, but for these next ones coming up, they're essential.
Yeah.
So I'm just going to hopefully get these one.
There we go. Aw.
There we go. And, oh, yeah, I'm past her. All right. So now that I'm here, I'm just going to remember to quickly upgrade.
Upgrade
for Gravity Typhoon, so now that one's 4 out of 4. And, alright. So this is the kids' fight.
The kids' fight. This is one of the most annoying fights. First of all, just in the game to practice, because of the way that the game saves, you have to be at your house to create a save in the game, and you basically have to go through the entire descent to practice this fight again. So it was one that we kind of, for a while, didn't spend a bunch of time with because it was just so annoying to get to, let alone fight itself.
And right here they decide, you know what, it was already bad enough, let's all say, hey, we got the can!
We got the tin can, we got the top tier object.
So that guy there, Steve, he tried to knock the can out of my hand, so he's not just...
He no longer gets to live.
Yep,
So we're basically, the thing we're trying to do right now is we don't want to worry about those swordfish, because if Gravity Typhoon comes back up, they take care of swordfish a lot easier than other moves like Gravity Typhoon or Gravity Kicks or anything like that does. So we try to take care of the ground enemies because they don't move all over the place and they aren't as obnoxious just to deal
with.
They
don't
overall.
Really try to dodge. The frog doesn't actively try to dodge you, it just, because of its sporadic movement, ends up dodging you. The swordfish do actively try to dodge you. But sometimes, one thing I never explained in this game is that gravity kicks get stronger the farther you are away.
Oh, that's true. There's a threshold. There's basically like weak and strong gravity kicks. Where if you're a far enough distance, oh, that was close. One of the annoying things about specials, at least specifically Gravity Typhoon, is that if you start it up, and you start getting frames of invincibility, but it's a little bit after the startup, and it will still consume your gravity meter if you get hit out of it, so you need to make sure that you put yourself in a safe position before you start it up so that enemies don't just cancel your Gravity Typhoon, because that would be a huge waste of time. And there's a couple places where it can get really annoying when enemies shoot little balls at you and stuff. The homing balls. Alright, so we got this little last wave coming up. Just a couple R's in these land sharks. They're just strange. They just stay underground and then pop up to try to fight you. Alright, so there we go, that's the kids fight.
And that's chapter 13 completed. So next episode coming up is chapter 14. So remember that thing we talked about earlier where Stasis breaks bone? That's coming up now. Steve, would you like to explain the I'm going to be going for the quick kill. I'm not going to do insta-kill.
Okay, so well...
I think we'll explain it later, but there is an insta-kill for this boss,
mm-hmm.
which will come up actually later on. But right now I'm going to go for the quick kill because it's much more consistent, and I'm having a really good run right now.
Alright, so the quick kill... the quick kill here is basically just rapid gravity kicks, as opposed to the insta-kill, which is some shenanigans with micro black hole. Oh, it's back up, but... The quick kill.
Should I go for it? Go for it. Alright, I'm going for it. Okay, guys,
we're gonna get it. There it is! Nice. So the insta kill, the way that works in this game is, that the micro black hole, the way we understand it, is that the micro black hole basically hits Nushi and breaks two of his little bone wing things he has, and the way we understand it is that the game basically is like, oh, you're breaking objects, okay, you're just gonna break everything with micro black hole, so then it instantly kills him, because it also breaks his one core that he has, and it'll also come in handy in another fight coming up
with the same boss, but now he has stuff in the back.
Yeah. And so this is kind of a tight segment right now. Basically, you have to,
right now, okay, I'm gonna go fast, then I'm gonna mm-hmm. save right after I hit him.
So you have to get to Nushi, and got it. Okay, so basically you have to just, like, hit Nushi's gem, and then, aggro him so that Raven, you can go to Raven on the plants, and, she'll, like, take care of it, basically. And it's three times you have to do it, And the thing is you can do it within one cycle because his core is only exposed when he tries to shoot lasers at the city. And if you don't do it fast enough, like right there, he hit it right when the core was disappearing. If he didn't hit it in time, then he would have had to wait for Nushi to just fly around and then wait for another cycle to come up. So that saves about 13 seconds, right?
Yeah, 13 to 17. All right, so who likes platforming? Who likes Mario? If you like Mario, I expect to hear a lot of cheering. Well, you're not getting it.
No.
This is not Mario. This is what I imagine is their beta testing for making sure Cat can platform, and they thought it was really fun, so they just kept it in the game.
I don't know
like
why
said,
they
like I said before, they like to add variety to the game.
I don't know why they thought it was fun. They're like, hey, people want to play Gravity Rush because they want to platform. No. So yeah, this is a pretty basic, like, there's a few nice little techs near the end of this, but, like, tech we have, but basically, like, this part, you know, there's cycles, and you just gotta wait it out, and don't fall off, because that's a waste of time.
I can fall off there, actually, because this thing, I have to wait for it to go all the way back here.
Yeah, you gotta wait anyway.
And then move all the way back. There is a quick cycle for this, so if you go, quote-unquote, quickly, you can make it, but so lenient, and then there's a maze right after you've done these cycles, and right, that's good, right?
Got it.
Alright, and then I'm just gonna jump right here.
This one doesn't take as long as the other two.
and then there's some actual platforming tech that is, I wish wasn't in the game, to be honest, because it's hard, and it makes, it could be a run killer. Right now, our run has been going very well. In fact, it's been going better than the current world record run, believe it or not. So this has potential for world record, because we're in world record pace right now.
And yeah, this upcoming platform tech is something that is really, it's risky, but it's also, and it's pretty specific, but if you can get it, it saves a couple seconds. How many seconds do you think it saves?
I never tested it out.
I think it'd be probably somewhere around at least 10. 10, probably 10 to 15. And we'll see if we can get it.
And in this run, that's pretty significant. Especially if you can go perfect at this point. Which, the only mess if I had is earlier with Sid.
But again, it doesn't apply to these rooms. So this is kind of a little, like, shifting puzzle. Because if you shift with the wrong thing, it'll shift you into another thing that'll just shift you out, and then you'll just fall into the abyss and have to restart. So it's a pretty straightforward pattern. I mean, you just kind of gotta follow. You basically just look at the shifter and be like, okay, is this one gonna shift me anywhere I don't want to be? And you're like, no, you're good to go. And
always consistent, so it's not. I thought I missed that. Okay. So here's the construct for this one. I have a setup for it.
I got it
first try. All right,
nice.
good.
So yeah, that little, just clipping that little ledge gives us a skip, because otherwise we'd have to walk all the way up, shift over, all the way, but now we can just kind of fall through, and as long as you touch her, you're good to go. And this again, there's another little cute skip here. It isn't as, like, strict as grabbing, as that other one was, but it's a pretty straightforward one where they want you to go, like, in one direction and do all these shifts, but here you can actually jump to this block right here, then climb up, then turn around, do a little turnaround jump.
I thought that was gonna be good.
Yeah, you jumped a little bit too far out.
That's the second mistake I've made in this run, which is actually not that bad, because I made this on my world record run. Alright, I'm gonna concentrate again.
Okay, so the thing is, too, is that this skip, like, you basically just do this until you get it, because it's a pretty large time save, trying to do it the way that the game designed it to be done. And then this jump is a little specific, but if you can snag the corner, then
there
you got it.
And, I have no control right now.
Yeah, this part we have no control, you can't evade cancel the landing lag here, you just gotta wait it out. You can't chain, you can't push her any closer, you just got it there. Now we can go.
I just listen to her lecture you. Awaken Sienya.
Sienya.
Sienya. So why not?
Just a, yeah, why not? You just gotta wait anyway. And they've got this whole interesting, you're this queen and all this stuff coming up, and then you just don't mention anything else about it for the rest of the game.
Gravity Rush 2, see.
I know, but it's just like, what was this? The ending's a little abrupt and just kind of like doesn't go into detail on these. This is like the most interesting narrative-wise of this part of this game, and then they just kind of say, nah, never mind, you can figure it out later. Near the end, so.
What's our time at, Steve?
We're at 1:14:53.
Oh, wow, that's really good.
Yeah,
that's
we're at a pretty good pace.
Really good.
Yeah.
World record pace? Absolutely. Only two mistakes, which is really nice so far.
Mm-hmm.
I even got instant nushi. I wasn't sure I was going to go for it. It's not too hard trick, but if you miss it, you waste a bit of time, quite a bit of time.
Alright, so this is final Nushi. This is where we fight, right here, we have a little bit of time while we're waiting for the game to kind of finish loading and autosave that we just grab a couple gems, because there's nothing else to do. And we gotta wait until that autosaving, and then now we can actually start the mission.
Alright, so Kari, Sanya, over. So now I'm about to do an upgrade, which is not actually necessary for the run, but it makes this next part more consistent. I'm gonna upgrade Micro Black Hole. What this will do, what I believe it's doing is increasing my radius, which is necessary to make this next part a bit more consistent. Another upgrade while I'm waiting. Upgrade my,
get another gauge usage upgrade.
So, just like the spider fight Kisiko, this is a sort of a scripted segment. Just for help.
Just in case.
Yep, don't want to die. Alright.
And cutscene skip when Raven turns blue. There it is.
Alright, I'm gonna concentrate for this.
Alright, so Nushi's gonna be coming up right here, and what we're gonna try to do is hit Micro Black Hole to try to break the gems and hit the bones, because it does a bunch of damage. And if we can get a good, if we can get... That was decent.
It could have been better.
Oh, yeah, that could have been better.
Oh, it got rid of the most important gem.
Yeah.
So, there are several gems on its back, but the one in the front is by far the most important because it has the quote-unquote most health.
Like, it takes the most gravity kicks to deal with. And this part is basically, as long as we can get him, it's an auto-scroller, like, we have to wait... We have to at least break his back gems before he does his first kind of laser beam part, like he did in the last thing.
Going
but
now.
Yeah,
I'm
the
going
issue.
Slow. I'm going slow. See if he's already dive bombing.
Yeah, the problem is that he is just so fast during this fight. Okay, there we go. So now we have to wait until he rears up to do an attack anyway, and then.
My indicator for that will be the
special meter coming back up.
I'm gonna crank up as many of these as I can while I can. Luckily, because if I went faster, it would click more, but unfortunately, I did not.
It didn't get the best micro black hole. That's a really specific. Okay, so now he's gonna rear up really soon.
No, I still have a bit more time because I went slow.
Oh,
there
we
go.
There we go. And. Boop.
Oh, okay. That was a bad...
Alright, and... The most annoying thing is the way that he finishes, you have to, like, turn the camera around. Because of how he, like, falls back. He doesn't just... It's not like the other bosses where it's just directly in front of you. So now we've finished the descent, kind of the bottom part.
End of the world is what it's called.
Yes, and so this is, Now we're doing the ascent, where we go back up, and then we finally get to spend some time in that beautiful city that we just decided to leave immediately after discovering.
But of course, we're still starting from the bottom up, so we'll be starting from the bottom of that beautiful city, because it's so pretty that we have to see it from the bottom up. I kid you not, yeah, that's just the way. Normally I would not collect these gems, but,
Because of
it doesn't waste a lot of time. I'd say it wastes maybe about 3-4 seconds to do this. About 1 point. It's not that much. But I'm collecting these gems because I want about 500. So I can upgrade gauge usage one more time. This is the last time I'll be upgrading gauge usage. And then I'm gonna collect a few more. I don't need any more. That's good. I just want to land on here. There we go.
and then we're gonna make
and
it all the way up
here. I have to fight these enemies with now Gravity Typhoon, so good that I will not be fighting any enemies right now. I'll just be going up here, and I'm just using this, take them all out. Swordfish, most important one.
Yes, Swordfish being the most important. Oh, he had one little gem left. There we go.
That was it. Sometimes you can kill them all, other times you might have one left. You know, it's not a big deal because just go up there and kick him. Just finish the job yourself.
And in case we didn't know, the gems are even pointing in an up arrow type direction. So be like, hey, go this way! Just in case you weren't sure.
Yeah, as if the game wasn't linear enough. Mm-hmm. If you weren't so sure, if you weren't quite sure after all the linear, go point A, point B.
And we personally have not discovered any super kind of game-breaking, sequence-breaking glitches or anything like that, but we know that there are a lot of glitches that we can't get consistent that could possibly be utilized, so that feels like there's a lot of development that could be done in this game. So basically, instead of going for the gems here, we just try to stay away, because if we get hit, it's a pretty big time loss, because we'll drop this guy right here, and we don't want to drop him, that's a big time loss. Now we hit him.
Alright, so I have to wait for that thing to come back. So I'm
we gotta wait for Gravity Typhoon to come back in order to complete this wave as fast as possible, so we're just gonna be... Oh, there it is.
Oh, you saw that! Yeah,
yeah, that was close. Get those swordfish. Those swordfish suck. And this is one of the locations where...
Oh,
you didn't get the spiny. You got a bait.
That's fine. He's gonna be aggro right in just a
second.
Well, that means I'll just collect these while I wait.
Yeah, might as well. Oh. So, the annoying thing about this is that there are a lot of really obnoxious enemies, and, at the same time, there are no objects in sight, like, anywhere in this area.
If there were any objects, we could finish fights a little bit quicker, but there are none. Absolutely none.
So.
Oh, and, kind of, that's one of our, me and C's, one of our favorite parts of this game. Alrighty, yeah, you get to see all of them.
This is one of the parts where we fast.
Oh,
no damage. Sometimes you get hit by that last one, but that's a really fun little dodging part. So now we gotta clear this last gravity storm. And there's this big, now we're fighting this Nevi. I don't think we fought. Oh yeah, we did, but the dragons, what we call dragon Nevis, that have a bunch of gems along their back. And then shoot balls at you and just kind of fly around.
There's only three in the game, and since they're all annoying to fight, this one being the most annoying.
Yeah.
I'm waiting for Gravity Typhoon to come back. While I'm doing that.
Oh.
Oh, well. It's fine.
And that's exactly what we meant by Gravity Typhoon getting canceled.
That was actually my fault. So that is not too big a time loss, but I mean, I actually have to fight the dragon legitimately. Possibly. Just gonna wait for him. Alright, so...
Another annoying thing is that those little wings that it has can just block you from hitting the gems on its back in a couple cases, which can just be annoying. Man, these swordfish are nasty because they have two orange gems, so they take more than one gravity kick to beat each gem.
I'm just gonna quickly grab this
health.
Yeah,
you gotta grab
health. And because you...
This fight is one of the most annoying and difficult fights. Just kind of, there's not a lot of utility. There's not a lot of, like, options we have. It's just kind of, well, gravity kick all the swordfish and hope they don't wreck you.
Yeah, that was kind of a big mistake because now I have to go. Usually I'd be done right now because this guy would be dead, but right now. I'll actually probably get the Jedi Fin back at this rate.
Yeah, you might as well just go for that last swordfish.
I mean, there's another one. Oh! Just gonna wait for these balls.
There we go. Wow, that almost got canceled again. That would have been terrible. I don't think he's fully in the dead yet. And
there we go. I would say I wasted 30 seconds, Steve. That's
pretty
bad.
Yeah, that's a sad... That's probably the biggest...
Our world record pace is now questionable, but, however... I did not mess up a few other things in my world record run that I have not messed up here. So I'd say I'm good. Alright, so now I'm gonna upgrade Stasis Field. Can you explain why we upgrade Stasis Field again?
So we upgrade Stasis Field to the maximum level, we actually upgrade it twice. And that is so we can, in the upcoming one of the chapters, we have to carry these sensors, and there's four of them. So, it allows us to, upgrade, it allows us to get those sensors all in one go, and, and it just makes that mission a little bit easier on us. And allows us to pick up more, it allows us to pick up more stasis objects for the kind of final upcoming fights.
She's so menacing right there.
Mm-hmm. She is. So that's why we grabbed that manhole, which actually was missed during the share play. Grab the manhole, go back to the city. Now we actually get to spend time in this city, and then we have to go grab these sensors.
But from the bottom up. Like, we're still exploring from the bottom up. We've already explored the bottom of the pillar. It was interesting, I have to admit. I mean, did you enjoy your trip?
Sure. Not as much as I would have enjoyed this city.
Alright, and then we get here, he asks us to do a quick bungee jump,
dropped
grab his suitcase.
Yeah, dropped his case. Good thing it landed where it did, jeez, that was like really close to just being lost in the abyss forever.
It was really close to being another trip down to the end of the world. Mm-hmm, that's how we got there, was dropping the letter.
Yeah, that letter getting dropped. And then you give it back to her as one of the little conversations, and she doesn't even care anymore!
Yeah, you can talk people through between missions. And she doesn't care. She has a new boyfriend.
Because you've been...
So...
all that for nothing.
Yeah, pretty unsatisfying. I feel bad for Kat. Actually, interesting in the way lore works in this game is that, the farther... If you go down, time moves slower. So, she's been... time moves faster above you. So that, so she's been gone, like, 2 days her time. 3 days or something... I know, a year up top, mm-hmm. up top. And that's why everything's different and yada yada, but, like we said earlier, don't get hit.
Yeah, don't get hit, because we have stasis objects, so if we get hit, or we run out of gravity meter, but that doesn't really happen, because we've upgraded gauge usage so much at this point. And, but if you do get hit, then it can be difficult.
It's a big time loss.
Yeah, because you have to go all the way back to pick them up again. And it depends on when you get hit and things like that. But at least only two of those, only two of the sensor positions actually have fights while you're holding them. And, one of them we just use Gravity Typhoon on because you're invincible and it's fast.
Alrighty, Steve.
We're almost there. We're kind of at the end part. So now, you go all the way back to him, just so he can tell you to turn it on, so you go all the way back again. Which is not
fun. Forgot to turn on one of the sensors. I don't understand why he forgot it. And I don't understand how Kat always seems to place that sensor. Every time I do a run, she always places it in the same place. It's very odd, I don't get it. She's just like, she knows it's off, and this is the off-sensor position. Alright, so kill all these guys. Gravity Typhoon wipes them all out. And then what I'm gonna be doing is,
I think you're good.
Yeah, I'm gonna come over here, grab three objects at least. That's good.
Yeah, you got four.
Yeah, four objects, one extra just in case things go horribly wrong.
And
what?
Yeah, just help.
Oh yeah, I have the boxes.
Yeah, because there's like the one of the barrels is, the boxes are one object. It's weird.
One, two.
So here, we didn't pick up the sensor because it's just an annoying fight, and if you pick up the sensor, you can't throw those objects, which makes that fight faster. And then, of course, if we got hit, it would not be fun. Alright,
so the thing is this fight is I walk over here, aggro these sharks, they come out of the land, I don't get it.
The land sharks?
I break their jockstraps.
Because they have jockstraps now.
And I get rid of this guy. Dodge because this guy's coming. There we go. Drop down and it comes back. Aim at this guy. Get up. And the dragon.
And that other dragon. That's the last dragon we really have to worry about.
And now all that's left is to kill this golem and the Rs.
Ooh.
Oh, One Punch Man just hit me. Thank goodness he's not actually One Punch Man. Alright, that would suck.
Hey, that special Nevi can be One Punch Man in the early parts of the game.
Oh yeah, these extra green Nevi, which we won't be getting to because they give you a ton of gems, but they're slow because, you know, you have to kill them.
Yeah, and they're super powerful, and they have one of the golem ones, and he's pretty much One Punch Man because he does a ton of damage.
Oh man, if you haven't upgraded your
health.
He is One Punch Man. He will one-shot you, so...
Anyway, so now we have to basically just do this guy's bidding as he says, like, oh, I gotta go here. And he's like, oh, never mind, I gotta go to my house. And then he's gonna...
That's what we've been doing all chapter, Steve. We've just been doing what he's asked us.
Yeah.
Put these sensors down. Fight these Nevi. Oh, my goodness, he
so
is
now
gone.
Here, and then he goes like, oh, let me see the clock. And it's like, don't you have a watch? Like, I don't understand. So he's
don't
like,
you have
I
a remote control for these sensors? Didn't you remember to turn that sensor on?
Yeah, I know. It's not. It doesn't make sense. And then we gotta get him to the airship so that he's not late to work.
Yeah,
his
even though he is the
boss will kill
villain.
Him. Yeah. Spoilers!
Oh, spoiler? Oh, yeah.
He
works.
No. No. If you're watching a speedrun and you don't want spoilers.
Yeah.
If you're this far into the run.
Eggs from my house.
So yeah, we gotta go back to the house because the next chapter is when you're taking a little nap and then you have a strange dream. One could say.
Chapters are hard to enter.
One of the most difficult, biggest time loss in the game. No. So now we have to find the pieces of Dusty because Dusty was split into 20 different mini Dusties, I guess we could call them.
Steve, what's my time right now?
131.35. Yeah, 131.40.
That's actually still really good.
So, yeah, in case it isn't obvious, I'm doing the splits because I'm recording this because I have a capture card. Woo! So...
Usually I do my runs using Twitch. Thank you very much, Twitch.
The SharePlay. Or the PS4 streaming. So yeah,
this is like the beginning of the game again, but now I can jump.
Yeah, so. We can actually jump and run, whereas you like walk for the first part. So we gotta get up these stairs, collect these little cats.
Oop. It is faster to jump to them because they will run towards you and they're slow.
As long as you hit the little barrier for it. And that's the 20th cat.
What am I at? Okay, so exact time.
You are 132.28.
That is really good. That is really good. Okay, we're on world record pace right now, Steve.
Alright, let's keep it up.
Steve,
yeah.
No deaths.
No deaths. Not like, honestly, I feel like the parts that give you deaths are like, you're more or less passed, but you never know.
Well,
Unica.
I died on Unica earlier.
So that part, I don't know why they start you exactly there where it's really difficult to immediately gravity kick them.
They want you to think, not just like aim fire.
But it's nice.
Steve aims. Aiming's nice, Steve. Alright, let's get ready. Wow. There we go.
There it is. Alright, get that cat, and then there's a second cat.
So Steve, if I look like I'm about to get hit, you know, get knocked out of something during Unica or during any of the boss fights, I'm prepared to say, Max, I think it's time for an upgrade.
Okay.
Yeah, just sometimes I'll just stop and be like, no, I'll survive, I don't need to upgrade health here.
It's not worth the death.
What?
The YOLO strategies. Man, the quality drop. Alright, so yeah, this fight... pretty much just straightforward, gotta beat the enemies. Here we grab this cat and drop as soon as we get it, because the other cat is immediately below you, which is nice. And if you get it right, you can actually drop and the first cat will like follow you down, and then you'll get like both cats around the same time. Grab a stasis object, gotta beat these pillars again. And then we're gonna fight another mantis, like that boss from the first rift. But this time we have significantly stronger gravity kicks. Oh. Fight the frogs.
No, and I use this here because I can.
And because it comes, yeah, it comes back faster than like Gravity Typhoon does. And we need Gravity Typhoon for the wave after
this. He is sticking his butt right there where
yeah,
I cannot hit
just,
him.
He knows the protective zone.
Just lure him out. All right.
There.
Sometimes you have to think on the fly like that.
That R right there, again, was one of the ones that was made by the pillar, so it doesn't count towards completing the wave.
Alright.
Oh, gotta get out of the way. So yeah, gotta fight this mantis with significantly stronger gravity kicks, but he's also a lot stronger,
No, he hasn't. Same strength.
No, well, I mean, he's just more defensive.
Luckily, we don't have to end the fight with the triangle.
Yes, we do not. So we use it in this upcoming... Oh, he almost got you. He really wanted it. That poor R's just been chasing you all over the place. He's like, I want to get him! I could do it! And last
He cannot, cat. Steve.
He cannot. No, he's just too slow. He's like, getting ready, and he just doesn't do it. Alrighty, here we go.
Alright.
So these are, this is the last wave of the...
The most important to get rid of is once again these swordfish, because they're the only one that dodges.
Yeah. Alright, that's good. Because the golems just stand there, so you can get them pretty easily. Got them. Boom! Get that thing. Alright. Now we just gotta wait for the death. And... Boom. So now we're upcoming to the last kind of chapter, official chapter. This will be the last movement in the overworld that we do, where we again start at the house and then go back to that manhole that we got in the fourth city.
Real quick, Grandpa, don't worry, I'm picking up Rosie, okay? Bye.
So this is
I have the car. I'll be fine. Bye bye. Yeah, sorry, I just had to answer a call.
That's okay. This is just, that was just a cutscene of now the military overlord is,
wants to make an announcement about the sea anemone. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna explain the sea anemone real quick. So sea anemone is this giant ball that can do fire lasers, shoot rockets, blah, blah, blah. You're essentially competing against it to see who can get rid of the Nebby first. I'm gonna wait here just for a moment. It's good. Yeah, so you're essentially competing against it. And what I want to do is I'm going to just quickly shift upward, and my gravity special should come back up. Here we go.
Alright, so...
Just because I waved there earlier.
Yeah, so these waves, initially we thought this was an auto-scrolling segment because it didn't seem like no matter how many Nevi you kill, it mattered. But we actually found ways to manipulate it and ways to best use our time here, because the sea anemone, this big boss thing, is going to be killing a lot of them for you, and there are some that like you just don't want to kill because he kills them so quickly that it would be a waste of efforts to beat them.
For example, this golem coming up, we could try to kill the golem, good luck. You'll probably never kill it before the sea anemone gets its shot.
Yeah, and the sea anemone
so it's right now, it's going to be in the position to destroy said golem. Here comes the golem now. He's about to... I'm waiting. I should go grab something. So, yeah. I could try to go kill that golem. I would not kill it in time. Oh, he's looking at me.
That took a lot longer than usual, it felt.
Almost hit me there.
Yeah, that was a little scary. So now we got these snails coming up. Gotta beat these guys. Oh.
So, okay, what you saw right there was what I call a prank. I call them prankster swordfish, because they will just that'll just fly at you, and because they go outside their zone they're supposed to be in, so they get teleported back, and so they just hit and run. It is absolutely hilarious.
It's an effective strategy. Really... So now our goal here is to,
So there's two more enemies left. There's three more enemies left that are important, which, so right now he just destroyed all the air enemies, and it's revving up to... Alright, here you go. These two. These two are the last two that are important. So you get near them, this one gets mad.
The thing is if you get close enough to Gravity Kick, you'll actually, like, exit the boundary that you're supposed to be in, and the game will teleport you back, so the only way to beat these is by throwing stasis objects at it. And the other one just would take so long that the enemy kills it faster, so we just take this time to grab a couple gems. While we're waiting on him to finish it off, and then that
and
there
comes Unica. So can you explain what the first thing we do with Unica?
Yes, Unica. So Unica starts by shooting a shot at you, but she's a pretty good distance away at the starting position, so you immediately want to use Gravity Typhoon, and you will get the invincibility frames right before the shot hits you. It could be right now. So this Gravity Typhoon does a buttload of damage that's really helpful in this fight, because she is pretty similar to how Raven 1 was. She's very fast, very mobile, and very annoying. And she gets these things, these little, like, laser, these balls that surround her that protect her from your gravity kicks and other things, that shoot lasers at you. So she just kind of protects herself, and it's a very difficult and kind of annoying boss fight to deal with because of how fast she moves. And when you do damage her, of course, she does the whole flying away with invincibility frame animations and things like that. So right now we're just throwing stasis objects to try to get those little... She has these little laser beam things protecting her, those little balls.
Which will shoot lasers, and they protect her like this. So one. Thank you. Thankfully, I have rapid gravity kicks, which will...
Oh, there we go.
She summons for stabilizers and Lucy's. That's what she's saying, isn't it?
Pretty much. The language in this game, we never actually mentioned it. The language in this game that they speak is some sort of, like, combination of French and Japanese, I guess we call it Frenchanese. And so it's...
And this should finish her off.
It's a unique thing, yeah. And then she's gonna go up to that left building that's, all the way over there.
This one I'm aiming for right now. You can see her, so...
And that's the Unica fight. Can be kind of random depending on what she wants to do and where she wants to go. Those kinds of fights can be the most annoying of them in the game. And now here we have the Sea Anemone boss fight, which is the final boss of the game. And the first form... It has this one eye, there's a one core. Well, actually, we have to kick it and be like, oh, we can't do anything for the first little part. And so in this first form, it has one core, and this boss can be a little annoying because it just spins around all the time, and the core just kind of moves a lot, and usually the auto-targeting can be pretty good, but...
Same strategy is always rapid gravity kick. Oh, thank you for the tutorial, game.
Yeah, thank you for the tutorial on the final boss. Basically saying that this destruction level, if it reaches 100, will lose us the fight because he'll destroy the city. But it doesn't. It's not a huge deal. That was a pretty good first form.
That was pretty good first form. Next form has three cores, and each core has its own autosave. So every time you destroy a core, you get an autosave. Pretty neat, pretty convenient.
Especially because his attacks, like if he hits you with his, like, get off me attacks, they can do a lot of damage. Like, at this point, it would two-shot you.
Three-shot me if I'm at full health.
I've been off me twice.
Depending on the move, like some moves stronger than others. And okay, so I'm just going to move up here, and so what I'm going to do is... There we go. Alright, so now we have the last auto section of the game. Can't do anything to collect gems, and the only thing we're gonna use these gems for is health.
If we need it.
So, I'm just gonna quickly grab these.
There's one down there, yeah.
So, collect these ones. We have 800.
We are totally fine. And there's nothing, honestly, there's no other important upgrades to spend our gems on at this point in the game when all we have is one form left before it's over.
What's our time, Steve?
1:44:44.
Oh, really? Mm-hmm. Okay, so we're not world record phase anymore. I don't know what happened. It was probably
that ascent fight. That's where you lost most of your time.
1:44:44. Yeah. I don't know if I can beat this guy fast enough. We'll sign up.
Right, there we go. We're at 1:45 exactly. When that.
One of our favorite cutscenes. Cat.
Dead. All right.
Let's see.
You would think that this super special move, which we wish we had throughout any point in the game, you would think that this would be enough to do it, but it isn't. So now they've initiated a self-destruct sequence and it's gonna blow up the entire town, so you have to defeat the boss before it would blow up. Game gives you 6 minutes, but honestly, we could do it way better than that.
So there's two forms. There's one which I'm just gonna be kicking constantly.
We basically have to hit a certain health barrier, or a health threshold. There we go. For now what we need to do is it has this like invincible barrier, so we need to get to Raven, who's gonna help us out in disabling the barrier so we can actually do damage to it.
So I'm gonna keep going.
I mean, we have to wait until Raven, she's right over here.
Okay, there you go. Alright, so I'm gonna concentrate for this.
Okay.
So now, I already know where Raven's gonna go next. Unica and Raven are both available. Right now, Unica is the one that's calling for me.
But Raven is the one. Raven allows, basically, Unica does a set amount of damage to the boss, and Raven allows you to do the damage, and since we can do more damage than Unica would, Raven is the better choice.
So I start with Gravity Typhoon here, and I just let it go off for a bit.
And then we cancel it because the end rocks actually do significantly less damage. One more. Oh, you didn't get it. Just go to Unica.
Where is she? Oh. Alright, not a big time loss. It's okay, I'm not gonna get hit again, right?
No, and there's health over here anyway. They got health all around him. Did he get stuck?
Nope.
Okay, good. Cause sometimes he gets stuck. He got stuck. Come on. There we go.
Alright, so that is the final cutscene. Alright, get ready on time.
I'm ready on time.
Time.
1:47:45. Not too bad.
It's not world record.
No. Not world record, but pretty good run. Pretty good run. That end game was just brutal. Dude, getting Gravity Typhoon cancelled on the Ascent fight. That just is never fun. But yeah, so this... That was Gravity Rush Remastered.
We really, really hope that you enjoyed the run, and that you'll consider adding us to the GDQ.
Yes, we would love to show this game. It's really new, it came out, in America?
February 2nd,
it came out February 2nd. So, and this is of course the remastered version. The game's about 3 years old, or it's 4 years old on Vita. It was one of the Vita launch titles, and the remastered is great. It looks great, and it's really fun, and it allows us to run the game because the controls are better than they were on the Vita version. But yeah, we hope you enjoyed, and we'll let you listen to this credit song because it's awesome.
All right, Steve. I'm gonna be heading out.
Okay.
Alright, Steve, I'm gonna close it down. Thank you so much for helping me commentate on this.
Yeah, definitely. Alright. We will talk to you later then.
All right.